Welcome back, everybody. Let's continue to talk just a little bit more about displaying data. We've looked at bar graphs for categorical data. We've looked at histograms for quantitative data. And we've looked at grouped histograms when that quantitative data is quite varied in nature. Let me just introduce you to some alternative plotting methods. This is a frequency distribution polygon. It's also known as a line graph, and it's actually pretty darn common. We can use a line graph in the same situation that we would use a histogram. So when we have quantitative data that is continuous in nature, we can use a line graph. Instead of plotting bars that are centered around each one of these values, we just plot dots, and then we connect the dots to form a line. And that creates a frequency distribution polygon, otherwise known as a line graph. Something you won't see nearly as often is known as a stem and leaf plot or a stem plot. These plots are really very interesting. Each data point is represented by the combination of a stem and a leaf. The data in this plot represents student scores in a course, and it's divided between students who miss class often and students who attend regularly. There's usually a code to help you understand how to read the stem plot. So take a look down here. If we see a stem that says 25 and a leaf that says 6, that means that one student earned 256 points in the course. So this leaf right here represents one student who scored 188 points. Here we can see two students represented who scored 195 points. Here is a student represented who earned 225 points, and then right next to him is a student who earned 228 points. So it's really a very interesting way to see how data is grouped together. And we can see of the students who missed class often, most of them were scoring somewhere in this range, between like 220 and 270 something. And of the students who attended more often, we can see they were scoring somewhere between 240 and 290 points, typically. So that's a stem plot. I find it very interesting, and I just wanted to expose you to it. Here's something that we're going to be seeing much more often as the weeks go by this semester. These two graphs are actually population graphs. For the most part, everything that we've looked at before represented data from a sample. But keep this in mind, some populations are so large, we can't really measure the entire population. So you might be thinking, how can you graph data from a population if you can't measure the entire population? Well, imagine this situation right here. Of these two types of fish, wildlife officers might know because of surveys that they've conducted that there are twice as many bluegill as there are bass. They don't necessarily know exactly how many bluegill there are, and they don't know exactly how many bass there are, but they do know their relative frequencies. They do know their proportions, and that is what is plotted on a population graph. Not exact frequencies, but relative frequencies, otherwise known as proportions. We can also create population graphs when we have quantitative data. IQ scores make a good example. IQ tests are created so that the average score will equal 100. So we know most people are going to score somewhere right around 100. I can't tell you exactly how many people in the population are going to score 100, but I know that's what we're going to find more than other values. So the relative frequency around 100 will be high, and the relative frequency around 130 will be low. Keep this in mind too. Some things that we plot aren't based on frequencies. Everything we've talked about so far is to some extent based on frequencies. Look at this graph right here. This is based on a study where people's reaction times are measured as they answer questions. That's commonly done in cognitive psychology. When people are told to respond as quickly as they can, they usually do respond pretty quickly, and here we're seeing average responses somewhere around a second and a half. In this case, you can see there's a very small difference in terms of when people are responding incorrectly to a question or correctly to a question. When people were responding incorrectly, it took them just a little bit longer. Their mean reaction time value was just a little larger. And in all the examples that we've talked about so far, whether we were plotting frequencies, relative frequencies, or in this case, means, we were always trying to plot the data in the most unbiased way possible. Well, sometimes people engage in dirty tricks with their graphics. Here are some numbers based from a few years ago for some hypothetical city, counting the number of major felonies that they've had over those past couple years. The numbers go from 42, 44, 47, 49, so it does look like major felonies are to some extent on the rise. Look at the story that this graph tells compared to this graph, and both of those graphs are plotting the exact same values. Most statisticians would agree that this particular graph right here is somewhat unfair. It's misleading because the bars are not sized in proportion to their values. Let me show you what I'm talking about. In 05, there were 42 major felonies. In 06, there were 44. This bar looks twice as tall as this bar, but 44 is not twice as large as 42. The bars are not in proportion. In this graph, the bars are in proportion because in this graph, there's a zero point. In other words, the entire scale is actually being shown. In this graph, there is no true zero point. Essentially, just the tops of the bars are being shown. So you should be aware that not everybody is trying to tell a clear, unbiased story of their data. Some people are trying to get you to believe what they want you to believe. Whoever made this graph right here, they really want you to believe that felonies are on the rise. But you know, it's also possible whoever created this graph right here, they don't want you to think that felonies are on the rise. So don't forget, sometimes the best way to tell the story of your data is not with the graph at all. Just display the numbers in a table. All right, we're almost done talking about displaying data. I've got one more short video that I want to share with you, and it discusses the shapes of distributions. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.